Okay, well, good morning and welcome to the History Forum. The history of the US-Canada border, today often described as the longest undefended boundary in the world, is often told as an American-British tale of treaties, wars, and eventual peace. In truth, Britain and the United States built this border across Indigenous lands, displacing existing communities and striving to disrupt Indigenous people's ideas of territory and belonging. While Canada and the US looked to the border as a marker of their sovereignty and diplomatic stability, Indigenous nations understood it as an obstruction and a threat to theirs. How might this multiracial, multinational history of the border inform our understanding of it today? I'm Annie Johnson, the museum manager here at the Minnesota History Center, and I'm happy to welcome Benjamin Hoy, Assistant Professor of History at the University of Saskatchewan. He's the author of A Line of Blood and Dirt, Creating the Canada-United States Border Across Indigenous Lands. Welcome, Ben.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for having me, and I apologize for not being able to visit in person. Before I begin, I wanted to quickly make a few thank yous. I don't know how many of you realize this, but historical research is a team game. It's rarely done by a single individual. I want to just quickly thank the many students and grant agencies who helped fund this, but also the archivists at the Minnesota Historical Society for inviting me to speak and for their endless help working on this book. The research I'm going to show you involves archives from about 30 different archives across Canada and the United States. And the Minnesota Historical Society was one of the best places I worked at. You have a real gem here. And then finally, it's customary in Canada to recognize the Treaty Six people, the Métis, the Dakota, and the Anishinaabe, on whose lands this talk will be given, as well as to recognize the Indigenous elders who have graciously made their wisdom available through repositories across Canada and the United States. Nothing that I'm going to talk to you today about would be possible without the depth of their historical understanding, which often exceeds my own. So the story that I'm going to tell you about today is about the birth of the Canada-US border. Now, this is a story that spans hundreds of years across the better part of a continent. It's a story about everything from the air that we breathe to the ways that children learn to bully one another. And as you're listening to this talk, I'm hoping that you'll pick up on one of three major themes. First, that Indigenous people helped to create the border that would define the very shape of the nations that we live in. And although we don't talk about it very much today, groups like the Métis, the Anishinaabe, the Cree, and the Stalo shaped the treaties that would define the border's path. They would carry the stones that would mark it on the lands, and they would help patrol the border during its early stages of creation. Now, the border that I'm going to talk to you today about would grow into something that none of these communities ever expected. But it's also a story, like I said, it's a reminder of how important Indigenous people are to the histories of Canada and the United States. The second sort of big theme that you'll see sort of woven throughout is that while the Canada-United States border is thought of today as the longest undefended border in the world, it's a border that is born in blood and dispossession. The story that I'm going to tell you today is only made possible by rampant starvation and disease, so devastating that you can see its impact in the polar ice caps 500 years later. And finally, the border that's created in the 19th century was never intended to create or to treat people equally. It was designed to be a wall of many heights, creating low barriers for some and almost insurmountable barriers for other. And this wasn't a mistake or an error in execution. This, in many ways, was part of the very conception of the border itself. So why does this matter, right? Well, this unevenness has some really long-lasting implications that remain with us today. It helps determine the distribution of ethnic groups in the United States, the ways that businesses and economic markets formed, and the ways that today you see airports and urban centers being treated with respect to international lines. But I'm getting a little bit ahead of myself. To understand what this border looks like and why it behaves the way it does, we need to jump back in time to get a sense of how a border manned by so very few people came to impact so many lives. So in 1927, Agnes Coffey Jones, a 40-year-old native of Cloquet, Minnesota, arrived at the port of Seattle on her way to Oakland, California. Now on paper, this trip should have been everything but just completely trivial, right? Should have been no challenge at all. Jones, for example, is born in the United States, and she was returning home to the country of her birth, right? Should have been easy. But her racial background and who she had chosen to marry created a number of unexpected difficulties. Jones was a mixed-blood Anishinaabe woman who had spent 5 years living in Canada. And her marriage to an Indigenous man from Canada would change both her tribal identity and her nationality. Now a widow, she'd become a foreigner in her own lands. When she arrived in Seattle, American Immigration Service members held her at the port, hoping to get clarity on her case. In the end, they let her pass, but forced her to pay an entry fee assessed only to foreigners. Had she crossed even 2 years earlier, prior to a landmark legal case launched by the Mohawk Nation surrounding the provisions of the Drake Treaty, if that's something that you're aware of, immigration agents would have prohibited her entry outright. Even with that legal victory, she still experienced delays and hassles and additional costs while making the journey. And Jones is not alone. Alice Barnes, a member of the St. Regis Reservation, faced a deportation warrant on May 10, 1927, while trying to visit family members. Other Indigenous men and women would face literacy tests and medical examination when trying to cross an international border that divided part of their people's homelands. So where this border came from and how it impacted the Anishinaabe, the Haudenosaunee, and hundreds of other nations like them, who never consented to the border's creation, is really the focus of my talk today. Created over more than a century, the Canada-US border did not emerge from a single conflict or act of legislation or administrative flourish. Right? The diplomatic negotiations around this border, which would set this more than 5,000 mile long border, took more than 100 years, which is kind of crazy if you think about it. The surveys are also very long and time consuming. The Pacific Coast, from the Pacific Coast to the Rocky Mountains, occurs between the 1850s and the 1860s. On the prairies, it's in the 1870s. In the Arctic, it's in the 1900s, right? So even just putting the stones down to mark the border spans multiple decades, depending on the region. Nor is this sort of an east to west process. The process jumps around. Surveyors moved from the East Coast to the West Coast before filling in the prairies, and neither country seemed to be in a rush. Like I said, decades would pass from the moments that treaties are signed around the border to the surveys that marked it on the land, to even something as simple as the placement of border guards or administrators who would make this border matter. And there's lots of reasons for this. The first is cost. Borders are incredibly expensive. Right, treaties are cheap, right? You can sign a treaty with almost anyone. It costs little more than the ink and paper that it's printed on. But power, real power, requires real investment. And to make that kind of investment, Canada and the United States often waited for moments of crisis. So on the prairies, fears of Indigenous people dominated. On the Pacific Coast, concerns about Chinese immigration, so-called Chinese menace at the time, would drive the border's growth. In the Arctic, concerns about gold would eventually mix with older concerns about immorality, immigration, and citizenship that first arose in the Great Lakes. This is a picture of one of the boundary survey tents. You can see that these are fairly crude in the 19th century. All of these are carried on foot or on horseback or in boats. So, you know, if you think about how long the survey process is, you can imagine some of the difficulty involved, right? We're talking about surveying an entire side of a continent. So if diplomats and politicians imagine creating a border that would help them gain control over a continent, the survey process actually suggested something else entirely. Canada, the United States, and Britain had set out to create a border that all but ignored Indigenous people. But in the process, they discovered something else entirely. They soon discovered their reliance on Indigenous labor and knowledge for doing some of the most basic features of what a nation state is meant to do. So Indigenous labor, like some of the individuals pictured here, and support underwrote the border at all of its stages. So Indigenous communities would provide scouts and translators. They'd provide guides and haulers, packers and canoe men. They would provision the boundary surveys, providing it with the food that these surveyors needed to survive. Haudenosaunee and Métis communities supported British officials in putting down Canadian rebellions and Irish independence movements who attempted to use the border for their own purposes. Cheyenne, Crow, and Bannock scouts assisted the American Army in preventing the Nimiipuu from fleeing across the border into Canada. Maybe one of the great ironies of all of this is that Indigenous scouts would capture Army deserters who attempted to cross the border, as well as provision the federal outposts on which the border patrols relied. So on its most basic sense, the United States and Canada are stationing soldiers along this border early on to protect it, but these soldiers live really hard and difficult lives, and many of them choose to desert, and it's Indigenous scouts who capture these individuals often and bring them home. So to give you a sense of how much labor and knowledge goes into making this border possible, I want to zoom in on two case studies. One in the Lake of the Woods, not far from where many of you live today, and the other on the Pacific coast. So the Lake of the Woods is located at the very northernmost point of Minnesota. It's that sort of awkward jet out point known as the Northwest Angle. Now this entire piece of territory is created largely by accident. When diplomats signed the Treaty of Paris, they inserted a provision that the border would pass through the Lake of the Woods on the way to the Mississippi River. But the problem is neither Britain nor the United States had any idea what was going on in this region at all. So they're sort of making a treaty blindly about the geography. And the wording that they chose resulted in a very awkward tract of land disconnected from the rest of the continental United States. But the problems went further. So early on in the 1820s, surveyors are sent to this region to place a handful of markers that are going to be sort of the backbone of all of the other surveys that happen. And in the 1870s, another set of surveyors returns, right, to begin a new process and to survey the land from the Lake of the Woods all the way across the plains, and they're going to end up near the Rocky Mountains. But the problem is that the monument that the United States had placed in this area has gone missing. So although Britain and the United States possessed expensive astronomical equipment and had set out to find something their own government had placed only decades earlier, they faced a real dilemma. The Lake of the Woods, as you can see here, is incredibly complex. It's just an endless series of bays and islands and inlets. The water level changes, changing how this area looks. And to make matters worse, a fire had swept through this region between the surveying parties. And all that remained of the monument that they're trying to find is a charred oak log underwater and embedded in the soil. And you know, you can look at this image and you can imagine how incredibly hard it would be to find a burnt piece of log underwater somewhere in the mud. The team would only discover this monument with the help of an old Ojibwe man who's left unnamed, whose knowledge of the area and of the previous survey proved invaluable. So Ojibwe knowledge, as this example suggests, is crucial to clarifying how international treaties, often created with faulty maps, made and marked with forgotten stones, would apply to the actual real world. The problems went a little bit further. Now, as you can imagine, trying to survey and create a border across the length of Canada, United States, that sort of area, we're talking thousands and thousands of miles, on horseback or on foot is hard and expensive work. Just the small segment located between the Pacific coast and the Rocky Mountains cost about $400,000 in wages in the 19th century and another $200,000 in supplies. Right, those numbers probably don't mean a lot to you. Well, if you translate that into days of labor, it's about 120,000 days of labor. So a lot of effort. And the cargo manifests might give you a better sense of the scale. So in a single transaction, the surveyors purchased 54,000 shingles and 40,000 feet of lumber. The supplies included 640 pounds of soap, more than 2,100 pounds of sugar, chronometers, telescopes, and reams of other equipment. They brought everything from marmalade to full-sized windows with them. And remember, they're transporting this across an entire continent, without automobiles or trains. And this gives you a sense of why they're bringing so much material. So they're building fairly sophisticated dwellings. They're out in the field for 9 months at a time, and they need places to stay. So it's an incredible logistical operation just to get out there with this many people. And even when the tasks seemed simple, the actual day-to-day process is never easy. So astronomical equipment told surveyors where they were in relation to lines of latitude. And that's great if you're surveying a border, but what if you want a drink of water, right? All of this equipment, all of this really expensive astronomical equipment does nothing to tell you where the closest source of drinkable water is, or which rivers are navigable and which ones aren't. So local knowledge was something that the Boundary Commission was always in short supply of. And they would turn to Indigenous elders frequently for support in that area. And in addition, one of the biggest sort of comical challenges with creating a border is, so you put the stones down, the sort of markers to mark the border on the landscape, but if you put them in the middle of a forest, no one is going to know that they're there. And so the sort of final piece of creating a border is what are called boundary cuts, which is cutting a swath of trees like the ones pictured here on the either side of the border so they're visible even in forests. But remember, you have to do this across an entire continent, which gives you a sense of how unbelievably backbreaking the work that underlays this border's creation is. So as both countries attempt to survey the area from the Pacific coast to the Rocky Mountains, they turn to hundreds of Indigenous laborers to offset their lack of knowledge and infrastructure in the region. The Stalo, the Semiamu, the Lummi, the Nooksack, and the Colville would provide the surveyors with saddles, with canoes and sleighs and planks of wood, with an array of foods. They would pilot steamers, ferry parties across the Chilliwack River. They'd care for animals, rent out their cabins, and they served as guides. In the Northern Cascade Mountains, detailed maps by Thussaluk and his father provided information on the pertinent river systems that the surveyors would encounter, as well as the Halkamelem place names that surrounded them. This gives you a sense of what some of the surveyors looked like. And the same is true in other regions. As this map suggests, Indigenous canoe routes allowed geologist G.M. Dawson to explore lands from the Lake of the Woods to Manitoba far more effectively than he would have otherwise. You can see sort of the complex ways that Indigenous knowledge is being translated onto European maps. Indigenous guides would carry messages between the astronomical stations and would serve as the very backbone of communication. They portaged heavy canoes across obstructed terrain, hunted and fished and gathered for the food necessary for these survey success. Nooksack men would construct river canoes in the field, allowing surveyors to explore long distances without having to portage canoes across the distance. What's really interesting is when you look at these records, you realize how much Indigenous families are an inescapable part of the border's creation. So this is a beautiful watercolor created by Donald Roderick Cameron, who's a superintendent for the Boundary Commission in the Prairies. And it gives you a sense of this. So in this drawing, the Boundary Commission's camp, you can see here, is filled with children, emphasizing the close connection that surveyors needed to make, not just with laborers, but with entire communities in order to secure this kind of support. Métis scouts pictured here served as diplomats across the plains. They would soothe out the relations with other Indigenous people on whose land the surveyors were entering. And recruiting this labor, whether it's for guides or provisioners, or in this case for Métis diplomats, was so important that both governments would discard their own ideas about employment in order to appease those they're looking to hire. So many Indigenous communities, for example, would refuse to supply workers unless the boundary team promised to care for their families in their absence, right? And this is, if we look back at this picture, why you see so many children in the depictions of these camps. So Indigenous communities, like I said, required that their families be taken care of or they refused to supply laborers. And to appease these demands, the British survey team would allow families to set up their camps near observation areas and would supply them with flour and bacon and other goods. The only exception that the surveyors seem to have remained firm on was its general refusal to hire Indigenous women. Across the entire boundary survey records that I've been able to see, I've only found two instances of Indigenous women who were actually on the payroll. Others may have been included, not mentioned by name, but in both cases, the women were used were widows who were transporting supplies, but very, very uncommon. So if the federal boundary, building a border, if it's so difficult, and almost by definition undermines Indigenous sovereignty, right? It's drawing a border across Indigenous lands, right? It's challenging their domain. Why on earth did Indigenous people put up with it? Why not just drive the surveyors out, or even more simply, refuse to contribute to their work, right? Refuse to provision them or supply scouts or anything like this? And answering that question is actually really complex, in part because of how large the scale of a border actually is. So it's worth remembering that the surveyors are visiting hundreds of different communities spread across thousands of miles of territory. These groups speak different languages, they possess different cultures, and they're also interacting with their surveyors over a really long time frame. In some cases, the entire process from East Coast to West is spanning more than a century. This is a map created by Hillary Rudd that shows the Coast Salish territory. So we're sort of in Washington State and British Columbia right here. And it gives you a sense of the complexity that's packed into even small segments of the Pacific Northwest. So this gives you a sense of some of the cultural and linguistic groups in both of the areas. In many cases, you could go, 10 or 20 kilometers or miles for that matter, and you'd be encountering three or four different mutually unintelligible language groups. So if you multiply that diversity across thousands of miles of territory, you start to get a sense of the complexity involved. Or maybe to put this all another way, there are hundreds of different communities who interact with the surveyors, and each one of them has a really unique set of stories. There do, however, seem to be a common set of justifications that, at least in the broadest sense, explain why Indigenous communities may have assisted or at least acquiesced to the border's creation and allowed the surveyors to move through their land. For the Métis, the Assiniboine, and the Assiniboine, fear of retribution is a deciding factor. Right, so fighting one colonial power hard, fighting two colonial powers, right, real problem. So in that respect, the Sioux, the Assiniboine, would continue to fight colonialism in the United States at many other opportunities. They would decimate Custer's forces, as you can see here, at the Battle of Little Bighorn in 1876, and would engage in a rolling series of conflicts and moments of violence with the United States. So to put this maybe more simply, they're not strangers to violence. In this case, however, they seem to be making a strategic decision to let the surveyors pass to try and minimize the chances of opening up a second unnecessary battlefront. You can see a picture here of sort of very iconic moment of the Battle of Little Bighorn created by Standing Bear sometime between about 1890 and about 1908. You can see that violence is really a part of this relationship. For other groups like the Siksikapi or the Blackfoot Confederacy, or the Crow or the Assiniboine or the Ah, many of these groups actually saw the border as something that they could use to supplement their own territorial control. So one of the sort of interesting challenges that all of these communities are facing that I sort of alluded to at the start is that at the end of the mid to end of the 19th century, the bison populations are disappearing on the plains. And each community is facing a crisis of subsistence, right? If you don't have food, right, you either need to find a new food source, you need to fight for the remaining herds, or you need to find a new strategy for bringing food to your people, whether that's wage labor or treaties or something else. So for many of these groups, the border takes on a very different meaning than it will today. They found themselves defending their lands that contained the few remaining herds on the plains from hunters that are coming from Canada, many of them Indigenous. So in this context, communities living south of the border but near the border began to see the border as a possible way of reinforcing their own territorial control. And they began to view American troops and border guards as auxiliaries for their own nations. Americans, for example, would send troops into the area near the border and would set fires to try and keep the bison south of the border. And they'd evict Canadian hunting parties where possible. Now, it's worth sort of clarifying. None of this is happening because the American Army has any respect for the territorial divisions of Indigenous people, nor do they necessarily are treating the groups south of the border with much respect or decency at all. But what they are interested in is keeping their costs low. And with bison supplies facing severe shortages and starvation, providing access to the groups who remain in the United States reduces the American government's need to supply ration to the communities which it just recently signed treaties with. And food in the case of starvation is one of the most common treaty provisions that you'll see in this area. So a few sort of caveats. So American soldiers never actually very effective at patrolling the border or controlling the herds, although they are trying all sorts of different strategies, like I said, like lighting fires. But for those facing a crisis of subsistence, rampant starvation that is causing the Cree and others to eat moccasins and parts of snowshoes in order to try and survive, even undependable allies held some value. For the Siksika, Skapi, the Crow, the Assiniboine, and the Aonin, and others who are interested in protecting their hunting grounds, disappointment, interestingly enough, sometimes came not from the border's creation, but that rather a few piles of stones rather than a wall would mark the line. The final reason that Indigenous nations may have allowed the surveyors to appear in their territory and sort of treat them with at least some level of respect seems to have been a desire across many of these communities to be good hosts and to try to create meaningful relationships with the new nations they were encountering. Now, if cultivating allies was a key motivation, it was not one that paid off. Canada and the United States would fail to honor the promises, almost every single promise they would make during the treaties, and use the surveying process as part of a larger operation to decimate Indigenous land and sovereignty. And this map here gives you a sense of that process. So this is a map of reservations in the United States in the 1890s. The areas in orange are the places where Indigenous people are being congregated. But you'll notice that all of this used to be Indigenous lands. All right, so in sort of the moment that starvation is coming across the plains, more and more Indigenous nations are being forced onto tighter and tighter parcels of land. So this is part of the story of the border's creation as well. So, over the span of a century, Canada and the United States had set out to create a border across an unbelievably wide length of territory. And they would do so often with the assistance of the Indigenous groups who resided there. Now, for all the struggles they encountered, whether that's the boundary cuts, right, cutting those huge swaths of trees or locating markers that are buried in mud or trying to navigate an area that you know very little about while on foot, horseback, or canoe, while all of those are very difficult, they pale in comparison to the part that comes next, right? Placing boundary markers is relatively easy. Transforming an arbitrary line that ignores geography, linguistic divisions, cultural similarities, and create something that was meaningful to everyday life, that is a very challenging task and required an enormous kind of investment. So by about the 1870s, 1880s, so this is sort of right after the Civil War, shortly before Canada and the United States had finished marking this final piece across the prairies, they began to rethink how on earth are they actually going to patrol or police this border? Right, there's no point sort of placing these markers if you're not going to do anything with them. And the earliest approaches to border control were really simple and they made sense. They focused almost exclusively on controlling and taxing the movement of goods, and they all but ignored the movement of people. And this makes sense, right? In the 19th century, almost all of the government's budget comes from tariffs, right? The money you charge when goods cross borders.
It's only after World War I that property tax becomes that sort of major source of revenue. So it's really easy to police a border, right? You're generating almost all of your government's revenue. So the handful of border guards that you need more than pay for themselves, and then they funnel money back into other branches of government. But policing people is really expensive, and it draws the very limited resources either country has away from other tasks, like soldiers or infrastructure, things like that. And you can see this in the actual records themselves. So into the 1880s, the United States could not even estimate the number of people who crossed the border in Michigan, across the Michigan border in any given year. Right? Not even controlling them, don't even know the number of people crossing. And as both countries sort of built this border and began to consolidate it, they began to experiment first by controlling the movement of indigenous and Chinese people. And only later, sometimes decades later, will they begin to worry about European immigrants. And you can see two pieces here. Two political cartoons that sort of play to this. So the one on the left is a Chinese man sitting outside the gates of liberty with buckets that's bags and crates that say industry, order, peace, and sobriety. And on the wall at the back, it says, notice, communist nihilists, socialist Fenians, and hoodlums welcome, but no admittance to Chinamen. The other image, you have Uncle Sam sitting in a chair with Miss Canada behind him. And Miss Canada is saying, well, Uncle Sam, I have no trouble with my Indian. Treat him no longer as a pauper or a pensioner, but give him good land and implements and tell him he has to earn his own, sort of missing, but earn his own being or starve and stick to your word. That's my plan. So you can see the kinds of ways that each country is thinking about each group at the time. Neither of them super positive. So as I mentioned, so making a border is a really rough task. As one of the commenters mentioned, right, the transporter status of the Haudenosaunee, the Iroquois Reservation in upstate New York is another example of a border that cuts right across a nation's homeland. But this isn't the only one. This happens to the Colville, this happens to the Cree and other groups. So it's not just that the border is separating different indigenous groups from one another, it's running right down the middle of each of these communities. So making that border seem meaningful, really, really challenging. And the problem in some cases seemed simple. In the 1890s, Britain and the United States had nowhere near enough administrators to guard thousands of miles of territory. Right? Even today, there are parts of the border that there are almost no border guards around. If you cross the Yukon-Alaska border, there's some where it's, you know, there's checkpoints that you're supposed to phone across, but there's not enough border guards to do so. In the 19th century, you can amplify that by a thousandfold. So the border is too long, and civil servants, border guards, far too few to ever patrol a border of this length. So they tried something different. Instead of trying to control mobility directly, they instead attempted to control the benefits gained from crossing the border or the perceived costs of doing so. So in practice, this meant controlling access to food, money, federal recognition, and job security, rather than, say, the border line itself. So instead of trying to stop people at the line, they're trying to control the reasons people crossed. And to give you a sense of that, I want to zoom in on a story that's happening near Leech Lake, Minnesota, which is pictured here sort of in Minnesota. And the other sort of location to keep in mind at the back of your head is Rainy Lake, which is located right on the Ontario-Minnesota border. So around the 1880s, so 20 years after the Civil War, Nene Arug Abe, who's then in his 50s, left the Leech Lake area in Minnesota for Rainy Lake in Ontario. Now on the surface, his transit seemed to suggest how little the border mattered for Indigenous people. At this time, neither government sent regular patrols along this region, and the checkpoints are few and far between, and there's a maze of waterways, more complex than the ones that I've seen here, that make it next to impossible to monitor movement. But power comes in many different forms. So while Canada and the United States, Britain and the United States, lack the ability to stop Nana Arug Abe from crossing their national border, they had the power to increase the hardship for those who disobeyed. And fear of punishment often stopped journeys before they began. So in the case of Nana Rugabe, his continued mobility threatened to deprive him of access to the rights owed to him under treaty. And while he was temporarily residing in Canada, just north of the border, Indian agents at Leech Lake developed a banned enrollment list. Now, these lists are really important. They determine who has access, who has a right to reside on a reservation, to collect treaty money, and to access services provided to the community through treaty agreements. And as agents are building these lists, they're intentionally excluding many American Ojibwe who are living in Canada. And when Nana Rugabe returns to Leech Lake 3 years later, he faces a difficult situation. Although this was his home, he's not a legally recognized member of Leech Lake at this time, right? He doesn't appear on the banned enrollment list. And this puts all of the power into the hands of men like C.P. Luss, the farmer in charge at the White Earth Agency. To Nana Rugabe's luck, Luss supports his inclusion. And in Luss's mind, the fact that Abe had never collected treaty money north of the border would strengthen his claim to land south of it. And this battle for inclusion is a really interesting one. Although Nana Rugabe had crossed the international border, he remained within the Anishinaabe's expanse of homeland. To add to the complexity, at the same moment that men like Luss are preventing the Ojibwe who temporarily relocate to Canada from claiming access to services south of the border, men and women from foreign lands were invading the Ojibwe's homeland. And the Anishinaabe understood the power that the Americans attached to simple identities and national belonging. And in the very same year that Luss is defending the inclusion of Nana Rugabe, he's also fielding complaints by settlers in the Kennebec County, Minnesota. This is sort of a picture of Leech Lake. You can see some of the beauty of this region. Now, if the settlers' statements could be trusted, the Snake River Band of Mississippi Chippewa or Ojibwe acted as drunken nuisances. The Anishinaabe would disparage their accusers in return. Zhu Yan, the chief of the Snake River Band, noted that many of the settlers who signed the petition were Norwegianers or foreigners, and they make a point of showing us hatred. Zhu Yan's approach would marshal American fears of immigration in an attempt to defend Ojibwe property and territorial boundaries. He would gloss over the troubled history between the Americans and the Ojibwe, and he emphasized the peaceful relations that had long existed between the two groups. The approach provided Yan with an opportunity to compliment the people he was requesting aid from, while also attacking those that he believed did not belong. Yan would demand that the United States honor the promises it made to indigenous people and called upon the American government to help enforce the rights against what the Ojibwe saw as a Norwegian menace. Penned in 1885, Yan's petition came amidst intensifying concerns across the country over Chinese immigrants, as well as immigrants from parts of Europe as well. And his concerns played, the petition played to the same kinds of concerns that nativists would use to justify the exclusion of Chinese immigrants and others. That is, that foreigners failed to integrate and deprive native-born residents of their opportunities. And for all the creativity of Yan's approach, for all its inventiveness, it played poorly with Luss. Luss could conceptualize transnational mobility in many different ways, but he had a really simplistic idea of belonging. For Luss, whose position in government allowed him to adjudicate these kinds of concerns, this entire matter was simple. He ignored the personal claims to land made by Yan and others and asked two simple questions. Quote, do you not know that you have no rights as a tribe to inhabit the country where you now make your homes in the Snake River County, Kennebec? And why do you not remain at Mille Lac where you properly belong and invade all controversies with settlers? So for Luss, the Snake River Ojibwe's only home remained at Mille Lac. Luss's decision, which he forwarded to the Commissioner of Indian Affairs, removed the Ojibwe's hope that they could draw on the federal government to protect their land from outsiders. The story of Luss, the Snake River Ojibwe, Zhu Yan, and Nana Rugabe told the basic truth about borders. The most visible forms of border control always happen with border guards who interrogate travelers and either deny them entry or allow them to pass. But border control actually goes a lot further. In Minnesota, it involved depriving Ojibwe who relocated to Canada of their access to treaty rights south of the border if they crossed without permission. Elsewhere, it would rely on denying individuals access to rations in order to force their compliance. It also involved defining who belonged. For Zhu Yan, the Snake River Ojibwe, protecting the integrity of Ojibwe lands required pressuring the United States to enforce its own borders more vigorously by turning away immigrants from Norway and elsewhere. For the Chinese, labor laws would restrict their ability to move and find work. Attempts to reduce the incentives for the border crossing, even if controlling the entry points, remained difficult. As the story of Agnes Coffey Jones at the start of the presentation suggested, federal law ensured that women's nationality followed that of their husbands, stripping American-born women of their nationality if they married foreign men. These kinds of policies, which we don't normally associate with border control, actually made the border meaningful to everyday life far more often than the kinds of border guards that you're most familiar with. Now, by the start of the 20th century, this older form of border control began to shift into what you might recognize today. The handful of posts that existed in the 1880s during Zhu Yan's time soon became an unavoidable network of posts. Checkpoints became common, and after World War I, so too did passports and other forms of documentation. The impacts of the border grew more visible, as these two maps suggest. The map on the left gives you a taste of what the Customs Service looked like between the 1860s and 1880s, based on the salaries expended at each location. Now you'll notice how concentrated many of these people are along the Atlantic coast, the Gulf of Mexico, and along the Great Lakes. Almost no one is being stationed along the west. The map on the right is from 1929 and shows you a variety of posts that existed at this time. Notice how many more have been added across the prairies. By this point, the entire country is encircled by border guards of one kind or another. And as this network of administrators grows, we could do something very similar with Indian agents as well. They're going to develop a parallel system of border control for Indigenous people that controls both their movements off reservation and across international borders. And this relies on a really old system that began in the 1880s and will develop over the next 30 years. And the premise of this is really simple. It's in Canada called the pass system. So Indigenous men and women who wished to leave their reservations were required to ask permission to do so. If they wished to cross the international border, they were expected to speak with Canadian superintendents located near the border before entering the United States. This, of course, only works because of cooperation. So American Indian agents, for their part, agreed to do all within their power to, quote, turn back all visitors not provided with Canadian passes and to use any other available means to effect the desired end. That is, these policies focused on controlling desired outcome instead of policing the border in an abstract sense. So even though Indigenous people could continue to cross the border fairly leisurely into the 1930s, their ability to, say, visit family members who live on an American reservation is quickly becoming restricted. So they're controlling the reasons people are crossing the border, not actually the border themselves, but border itself. So even into the early 20th century, like I said, neither government has much ability stopping Ojibwe travelers from crossing the borders if they want to visit friends or family at Leech Lake, right? The Ojibwe know these watersheds better than the federal agents do. And instead of fighting a losing battle, Indian agents, like I said, would turn to controlling food and family to shift the battlegrounds from the international border to areas like reserves and reservations where their personnel tends to be more concentrated. I want to give you a taste of how this plays out in everyday life so that you can see sort of the importance of this. So over the preceding century, military defeats, declining options for subsistence, demographic upheavals caused by disease and immigration had created continent-wide changes. It entrenched reserves and reservations as basic building blocks of Indigenous life. And for those living on these reserves and reservations, Indian agents began to wield a kind of course of power that few other federal officials could ever muster. In Minnesota, Indian agents at Leech Lake would deny employment, rations, and supplies to Ojibwe men and women who painted their faces or participated in ceremonies or resisted the whims of the federal government. Now, these agents couldn't force adults to adopt a Western cosmology in their heart, but they had the power to starve out those who publicly rejected it. And this international pass system drew on a powerful network of coercion, reservations, and surveillance, but like most federal enterprises, never quite worked as planned. Superintendents sometimes received information months after the trip was supposed to have began, making the logistics of the entire system a little bit cumbersome. Still, there's a lot of power in this approach. They would evict visitors and intervened on behalf of their counterparts on the other side of the border. It really didn't need to be perfect. It was capable of inspiring fear and creating change. So by the 20th century, most of the individuals who live near the international border are beginning to incorporate at least a part of the border regime into their daily lives. Overseas immigration, overseas migrants are facing heavy restrictions at port cities. Hundreds of new border guards are being placed along the 49th parallel, increasing the ability of both governments to capture illegal border crossers. But the breadth of territory is still really tricky. Even the most devoted and tireless agents aren't able to police this consistently. But like I said, in some ways they didn't need to. By the middle of the 20th century, Canada and the United States had achieved a far more subtle kind of victory. Belonging increasingly ran across national lines, and both governments had succeeded in projecting fear, uncertainty, and commonality into the interior. So by infiltrating everyday life, local understandings of the border helped to stop movement well beyond the capacity of administrators directly. In 1931, for example, Mary McCall was visiting her family in Oregon, and while there, she noticed an abundance of food in contrast to the sparsity that she knew in Saskatchewan. Her cousins noted that so much of the food in Oregon remained unsellable and simply went to waste. And her cousin confided that, quote, if there wasn't for an international borderline and customs between us, we could ship carloads of food into your neighborhood. McCall's approach to the food shortage emphasized how imposing a barrier the border seemed to be by the 1930s. Instead of finding a way to bring goods across the border from Oregon, McCall looked for parallel opportunities in Canada. She began a letter writing campaign in British Columbia, which she believed would have a similar surplus of crops. In doing so, she began to try and solve the problems within the nation state rather than reaching beyond it where clear possibilities existed. If the border presented an economic barrier to McCall's charity, it had an almost ethereal presence for others. Edward Dienst moved from Illinois to Saskatchewan in 1908 on a doctor's recommendation. Perhaps his asthma would yield to a drier climate. As Dietz remembered it, he started to feel better right away. Quote, at the border, you might say, the air seemed to be different, light and everything. I started to improve and to get better. Josephine Handy Gerdahl had visited Canada twice before her family relocated there when she was a young girl. Her peers teased her on her arrival. She used American terminology like writing tablets and galoshes instead of their Canadian equivalents, scribblers and galoshes instead of writing tablets and overshoes. But her family's position in the community shielded her from further abuse. When she complained to her grandfather about her treatment, he told her that, quote, if any of those teachers or those kids aren't nice to you, you just tell them that they can't have access to the water out of Grandpa's well. After that, she had no trouble. The well, which the community relied on, provided a social protection for Gerdahl as she transitioned to a new social dynamic north of the line. So Dienst would measure the border in terms of air quality, Gerdahl as childhood bullying, and McCall as an impediment to charity. Attempts to centralize the border's administration had done little to destroy the fractured ways that people identified themselves with respect to international lines. Even within settler communities, the border came to mean different things for different people, a common word to describe an endless array of possibilities. For Indigenous people, the border's impact on daily life into the 1930s had a similar unstable impact. For some, it seemed like a trivial impediment. For others, it cast a shadow across the ends of their lives. Oral histories by Mary Jourdain and Two Voices suggested the ways the border had come to structure everything from heartache to self-esteem. Mary Jourdain is born in the 1920s at Basswood Lake on the border between Minnesota and Ontario. Unknown assailants would chase Jourdain's family out of the area when she was too young to remember any of the details. Her family moved from Lake Lacroix, Ontario, back to Tower, Minnesota. In her words, she grew up in both places. And like many of the others living near Vermilion Lake, Basswood Lake, Burntside Lake, and Lake Lacroix, as well as Prairie Portage, Jourdain's family moved back and forth across the line with few impediments. Her family collected rice, wild rice at Basswood Lake seasonally. She attended Indian school at Tower, Minnesota, and lived in both Lake Lacroix and Vermilion Lake, so Ontario and Minnesota. Set against the backdrop of Prohibition, the Indian Citizenship Act, and the Great Depression, Jourdain's early childhood highlighted the existence of an open, often less federalized border than the maps of federal personnel suggested. But for others, like Two Voices, the border offered something else and different, something else entirely different. It was a sadness, not an opportunity. Two Voices was an Ojibwe who lived in the United States who traveled to Canada to visit. When he attempted to return to the United States, American immigration officials prohibited his entry on an account of an eye disease. At the time of his interview on the Canadian Plains by D.G. Mandelbaum, who's an anthropologist, in 1934, Two Voices had not succeeded in returning to the United States. At this time, he's estimated to be about 105 years old, and he likely faced a decision that would prevent him from returning home for the rest of his life. So from 1865 until 1914, the border would experience a short but rapid growth. Federal power expanded across an entire continent, adding new resources and opportunities for border control. And like a human adolescent, the border developed during a time period that was filled with awkwardness, unevenness, and doubt. Regional problems resulted in the border being pulled in different directions. The persistent autonomy of local agents created wide gaps between the laws that were written on the books and the policies that were put in practice. And each of these challenges would leave a mark on the border scope and its execution across the rest of the country, across the rest of the century. And by the time that Agnes Coffey Jones felt the sting of the border's impact in the 1920s, Canada and the United States had grown their border in both its size and complexity. They deforested an area 20 feet wide across the border's path, across an entire continent, and placed more than 8,000 boundary markers to indicate its location. They created powerful organizations to manage its operations. And for the communities who interacted with the border on a regular basis, the growth of federal power never felt simple or linear. The border seemed to close for the Assiniboine, the Sioux Confederacy, the Nimiipuu, and the Métis starting in the 1870s and 1880s. It would close for the Chinese and Coast Salish in the 1880s and 1890s, and for African Americans and Europeans closer to the turn of the century. It tightened for the Haudenosaunee at the turn of the century, only to reopen, as it would for many Indigenous communities, beginning in the 1920s and 1930s. That unevenness of the border's creation remains as one of its most enduring qualities. Today, the border continues to act as a wall of many heights, allowing easy movements for some, while as this recent news story that just came out a few days ago suggested, it remains a lethal barrier for others. Thank you.
Ben, thank you so much for sharing that history with us. We're gonna take some time now for a Q&A. I know we do have, I think, a couple of questions. And if you want to pull up the tabs. So the first one, in Polk's election of 1844, the slogan 5440 or fight was popularized. How would that have impacted the border, Indigenous people, if that part of Canada had ended up in the United States?
Yeah, so it's a really wonderful question. So for those of you who don't know, I wish I had these beautiful cartoons. They're absolutely wonderful. There's an image of Uncle Sam standing beneath a tree, and in his basket are, like New Mexico and many of the other places that the United States has taken over the preceding decades. And on the tree are a number of locations on apples that are waiting to fall off, and one of them is labeled Canada. And the cartoon is titled something like Patient Waiters, and Uncle Sam is in the cartoon essentially waiting for these apples to drop into his lap. And that sort of mentality is part of what you're talking about with the 5440 or fight. So the United States buys Alaska, not because it wants some piece of territory that's unconnected to the rest of the United States. It plans to take what is present day British Columbia as well, taking an entire section of the Pacific coast, right? Very, very powerful if you can control all of the shipping across that. So there's sort of a push initially to take British Columbia, and that's where this slogan 5440 or fight, that's the lines of latitude and longitude that the United States is trying to claim. There's quite a few things that would change had the United States gained that territory, and there's a few things that would have stayed the same. So what would have stayed the same is that both countries cooperated to put down Indigenous resistance. So in the 1840s and 1850s, Britain would, for example, send ships, sometimes munitions, but not necessarily soldiers, to help the United States in violence against Indigenous people. So both countries sort of see a common sense of whiteness as more important than their national identities in some cases. The British government fears that violence south of the border is going to spill up north into Canada. And so that's part of the reason that they're supporting, they're giving loans to the United States and other things like that. So in sort of the most basic sense, both countries have a similar mentality, a similar sort of outlook on Indigenous people at the time. The main difference is that the United States is much larger, has a much larger army, and is much more willing to fight. So Canada will engage in sort of outright violence only a handful of times, preferring a treaty process, in part because the Canadian budget around the 1867 is about $30 million. And that same year, the United States spends $30 million or so fighting Indigenous people. So it's simply not viable to engage in that kind of rampant violence in Canada as it will be in the United States. So in terms of outright violence, I think you'd see more of it. But in terms of the long-term pieces like reservations, like assimilation campaigns, other sort of pieces like that, I think the long-term legacy would look more similar than you'd imagine. And Brad has tossed the cartoon that I was talking about, Patient Waiters Are No Losers, into the chat. Really wonderful piece. That one's from the, I think, 1890s, if memory serves me. But that mentality, it goes back decades earlier.
Excellent. So our next question, is there anything you can add on the transborder status of the Iroquois Reservation in upstate New York?
Yeah, so, first of all, that's not an area that I study, so I can only give you a sort of preliminary answer. It's a really interesting and complicated question. But there's a really interesting moment in 1924 that comes out of that area of the country. And it's the Paul Diabo case. It's a sort of landmark court case that defines how the border operates across all of the United States. So the Mohawk Nation at the time is, they're iron workers. They send people all over Canada and the United States to build bridges and skyscrapers, like the very sort of infrastructure of modernity they're a big part of. And Diabo is one of these iron workers, and he launches a legal challenge for his right to cross the border under the Jay Treaty, which is sort of this, like I said, really important sort of moment. And 1924 is important for two reasons. You have a moment of immigration law being passed, and you have a new form of citizenship, the Indian Citizenship Act, which grants Indigenous people citizenship if they're born in the United States. And these two pieces of laws interact in a really awkward way. And so Diabo, who's crossing the border for work through this area, is encountering this in really sort of oppressive ways. And if the two policies are implemented together, the Department of Immigration Service seems to think that individuals, Indigenous people born in Canada, not only can't immigrate to the United States, but have no right to even make general crossings because of the ways the language is phrased. And so for the Haudenosaunee or the Iroquois nations, who the border literally runs right down the middle of their community, like right through the middle of it, you can imagine that this is untenable, where you can't, not only you can't immigrate across this border, but you can't even cross it on sort of a day-to-day ability to work. So really, really challenging situation. And so the Haudenosaunee, the Mohawk and others, gather a large amount of money and fight this in the courts, and they win. And this is one of the reasons that you see the Jay Treaty still in operation today. There's a series of legal battles after that, but that comes out of this region that you see this sort of untenable situation because of how the border is drawn, changing into national policy across both Canada and the United States. So sort of one of those moments where you can see that sort of impact and then the spread to the national story.
Another comment, but I think we can turn into a question about from the news lately that just this past week, an immigrant family from India froze to death in a blizzard while attempting to cross the Canadian-US border where it's unmanned. Is there any like history for the unmanned parts of the border, how that's been dealt with, or?
Yeah, so this is one of those fundamental challenges that, like I said, is sort of born in the 19th century and we're still dealing with today. There's large parts of the border that you can walk across. There's very few guards, but as you saw with the story that I ended off with and the one that Mary Lund is pointing to, it's dangerous, right? You know, temperatures in Saskatchewan up until a couple days ago were negative 35 Celsius. I think that works out to about the same in Fahrenheit. You know, ripping winds that, you know, put the temperatures down into, you know, negative 55, that range. This is a dangerous, inhospitable landscape to cross. That's part of the reason you don't have border guards here. And so today, one of the big legacies that they learned in the 19th century is that guarding a border is expensive and difficult. And what they do is they actually make the border wider. So instead of trying to stop people at the line itself, they begin to control access to all kinds of privileges. Right, and you see this with SSN numbers or SIN numbers in the United States, right? Your ability to work or to access medical care without fear of being turned over to immigration officials, right? You're controlling all of the things that people want to do while in the country that they're immigrating to. So that's often how they begin to patrol this today in a way that is similar to the past. The only sort of difference that you see in this regard, I think, is actually technology. So a lot of these unmanned sections have drones or motion sensors or infrared detectors, things like that. Some of them have telephones that you're supposed to sort of phone when you cross. So technology has changed how this is managed, but the fundamental problem that you're talking about remains just like it does, just like it appears in the 19th century.
I think we have time for one or two more questions. Here's with so many different tribes and languages, how did interpreters fit into the border surveys?
Yeah, it's a great question. So awkwardly, the answer is awkwardly. So this is another reason that groups like the Métis become so important. So I mentioned that in the 1870s, they serve as diplomats across the plains. And part of the reason that they're able to do this is they often have family that they can draw on, as well as frequently they're dual lingual. So that they can act as translators, they can provide information as you cross. But some of these surveys get really, really complicated. So I was just reading about one of my graduate students is writing about the Lewis and Clark expedition, and there's parts of that expedition where you're going through five or six different translators in order to get from English into French into, you know, all like four different indigenous languages to finally get to the one that you want to end up at. By the 1870s, it's a little bit less crazy, but you're often going through one or two translators at minimum to translate this. And translating really difficult concepts or abstract concepts like territory leads to a lot of misunderstandings, especially around treaty negotiations. And so there's been a lot of work being done recently to speak with elders and knowledge keepers to try and rebuild indigenous understandings of these treaties and what they thought the border was meant to represent. So in some cases, these treaties were never meant to sell land. They were meant as a more like a lease or sort of a land sharing agreement, or they were meant to apply to only the depth of a plow, right? So that you could farm, but not necessarily to mineral rights or other things like that. So the quick answer is translator is really important, and it's really, really complicated because conveying terms across languages, sometimes there's just no actual equivalent in another culture.
Okay, we'll do one last question. Let's see, was Point Roberts, Washington, a smuggling haven for goods and people? And did other havens exist before the US prohibition havens popped up later in history?
Yeah, so Point Roberts is just a mess. So this is one of those other really dumb pieces of territory that probably could have been resolved 100 years ago had Britain and the United States been a little bit less argumentative. So for those of you who don't know, Point Roberts is a little peninsula that juts down in sort of the BC Washington area. And the problem is, so here's your peninsula and here's the 49th parallel that runs right across. And so today, children from Point Roberts have to go from Point Roberts by bus up into Canada, across Canada, and down into the United States every day to get to school. right? You could have just made the border dip down and include the peninsula. That probably should be a part of it. But the idea of giving away any amount of land to the other country was a real problem. They could have traded the Northwest Angle and Point Roberts. It could have just been handled a little bit better, but it wasn't. So Point Roberts becomes just an absolute smuggling haven. British Columbia is really, there's just waterways in every direction. There's tiny islands. It's very hard to catch people. Smugglers have this awful habit of just, when you're on a boat, you just look around and you're like, is there another ship near me? No, well, now I'm gonna cross the border. And so they'll just park themselves next to the border and wait for customs agents to get tired and go away. And then they'll cross the border and smuggle. So Point Roberts is sort of a big part of that history, where it's an unmanageable area in the 19th century. And there are other havens that will pop up across some islands off the coast of the East Coast are used. A lot of the smuggling that you see during the Prohibition is done over waterways, because like I said, you can just park an enormous boat, wait till everyone's gone, and then just drive it up, dump your cargo, and then get back to international waters quickly. So it's specifically on the East Coast and the West Coast, it's even more unmanageable, as well as places like Detroit, where there's a very small river. You can just get a very fast boat, drop your cargo and go. Smuggling is almost impossible to stop in the 19th century, I guess.
So that is our time for today. Thank you again to Benjamin Hoy for joining us for the History Forum, and to the Charles A. Lindbergh Fund for its generous support of this program. Please join us next month for the forum, where we will explore the history of the American heartland with Kristen Hoganson, history professor at the University of Illinois, Champaign-Urbana. Thank you.